Good afternoon, gentlemen, ladies. It's now 1 p.m. As chairman of the Senate Committee on Public Information and Mass Media, this public hearing is called to order. Today's hearing is being conducted with the Committee on Justice and Human Rights, a secondary committee. Two main issues will be discussed, and the first part would be on legislation combating cyber pornography. Of three bills and five resolutions plus privileged speech of Senator Loren Legarda on the matter. And the second part would be on the resolutions on mass media killings and the country's reputation as a dangerous place for journalists as authored by Senator Miriam Defensor Santiago and this representation. On the first issue, the internet has revolutionized the world like nothing before. It has become a mechanism for information dissemination and communication between individuals without regard for their geographic location. With the rise in popularity of the internet, so does the concern over the dangers posed to children, teenagers, and women. Stories of children being lured into sexual exploitation by adults, prowling on the internet, cyber sex chat hubs in the disguise of a classroom have been prevalent as of late. It is for this reason that we are crafting and strengthening legislation to combat cyber pornography. On the second issue of media killings, we shall have the following backdrops as we formulate the necessary legislation. First, media killing in 2014 on April 6, Rubilita Garcia, Remate tabloid reporter and block timer of DWAD radio station in Cavite, was shot at close range in front of her house in Barangay Talaba in Bacoor. Garcia was able to tell her son, Tristan, minutes after she was shot, that the alleged brains behind her shooting was a certain police officer. There have so far been 9 incidents of attack and threats against journalists and media workers in 2014, including 3 death threats, 2 physical assaults, 2 instances of being barred from covering events. In 2013, there were 68 incidents of attacks and threats and 14 journalists murdered. According to the Center for Media Freedom and Responsibility, 140 journalists and media workers were killed since 1986, which excludes non-work-related killings. 2014 ranking of the Philippines in Global Press Freedom Index, 149th out of 180 countries. This is released by Paris-based press freedom watchdog Reporters Without Borders, making the Philippines one of the most dangerous places for journalists. The New York-based Committee to Protect Journalists ranks the Philippines as the 3rd worst in its impunity index of countries that failed to combat violence against the press. So to formally start the hearing, allow me to acknowledge those that are present here today. Thank you for your time. Of course, we have Asa Geronimo C. of the Department of Justice, Police Chief Superintendent Augusto Marquez Jr., Department Director, DIDM-PNP, Ms. Mary Wilsie Candelaria, Catholic Bishops Conference of the Philippines, Assistant Director Paz Sarino, Protective Services Bureau of the DSWD, Mr. Ronald Aguto, Chief of Cybercrime Division, NBI, Attorney Roda Cisnero, National Advocacy Director, IJM, and Mr. Alwin De Leon, Country Manager, malayo na yan. Thank you. Thank you, sir. And the ones for the media killings, we have Mr. Joel L. C. Eggo of the National Press Club, and Mr. Benny Antiporda, Confederation of Asian Journalists. Welcome, sir. Good to see you again. Gentlemen and ladies, may I request so that we will be able to cover as much as we can in the 2 hours allotted to us today, that you limit your presentations as much as possible, unless you're the main presenter for your particular group. If you have any questions in response also to questions, if you can limit your answers. And if there's anything not included, we will welcome and we encourage you to submit position papers so that we can do our committee reports with the necessary facts from your different departments and also from your particular inputs. So to start, does anybody have a presentation to make?
We are prepared, Your Honor, to give a presentation on media killings. I have with me the head secretariat of Task Force USIG of the PNP.
Okay, please go ahead and direct the presentation.
By the way, ma'am, the PNP delegation is headed by me. I am the deputy director of the Directorate for Investigation and Detective Management. I have with me Police Senior Superintendent Benjamin Silo of CIDG, Police Superintendent Henry Libay, the Secretariat of Task Force USIG, in charge of extrajudicial or extra-legal killings, Police Senior Inspector Robert Reyes of the Anti-Cybercrime Group, and Police Senior Inspector Attorney Catherine Tamayo, the Legal Officer of the Women and Children Protection Center. May I ask Henry Libay to please explain?
Good afternoon, Your Honor. And to our friends also from National Press Club, President Joel Egco and Benny Antiporda, and to ASEC Caesar, good afternoon. So I would like, ma'am, would like to give the everybody an eye view on what the PNP is doing, particularly on the issue of media killing.
So before you begin, I'd like to acknowledge the presence of Senator Nancy Pinay. Go ahead, sir.
The PNP function, as specified, ma'am, in the Section 24C of the RA 6975, we would like to emphasize that one of the primary functions of the primary law enforcement agency of the PNP is to investigate all crimes. And this includes cases of Islamic media practitioner that is happening in our country today. On May 13, 2006, there is a PNP task force that was created, Task Force USIG, particularly under PNP letter of instruction, and the function of the task force or its mission is to supervise, monitor, and cause the investigation through the creation of the so-called Special Investigation Task Group of Islamic media practitioners who were killed due to their work-related circumstances, newspaper commentaries, which we considered as an attack on press freedom. We also supervise killings of death of foreign national as well as killings of political activists. To give you, Your Honor, a picture of the total numbers, we're referring to the cases since 2001, starting from the former administration up to the present. We have recorded 115 cases. But we're aware, ma'am, that from 1986, as reported by CMFR on the 140 cases. Now, of these 115 cases, again, all of these cases are being investigated by the PNP. We have 48 work-related cases for purpose of classification as those that were killed due to their work as media practitioners. We also identified 43 cases, or 37%, as non-work-related. And then there are a number of cases where it was reported as a media, but it so happened that during the conduct of investigation, some of them were actually disc jockey, some of them were drivers, and some of them were even employee of the local government. And these are 21 cases. Next slide. We will now go, ma'am, on the 48 cases of work-related Islamic media practitioners from 2001. We have about 36 or 75%, and the remaining 25% are still under investigation. Of these 36 filed cases, these are the perpetrators. We have, unfortunately, ma'am, we have 7 policemen who were involved in this 36 cases, but only the remaining one of them are still at large. The rest of them were already accounted for and have been dismissed from the service. We have 5 government officials. We have mayors, barangay captain. We have one members of the CPP-NPA. We have one AAP personnel, and the rest are civilians. of these 36 filed cases, we were able to identify 73 accused. 26 of them were arrested, 13 surrendered. We have 8 convictions of 8 accused. 7 died of various causes, while the remaining 19 remain at large. Oh, just to show Your Honor, the some of the cases where we have conviction, the Edgar Damalerio, Marlene Esperat, Clayne Cantoneros, Armando Pase, Ravel Adrenal case, of course, the very latest Jerry Ortega case, where we were able to get conviction of the gunman. These are the yearly statistics of cases from 2001 to present. Particularly on 2003 and 2004, as well as 2013, we have recorded the highest number of 6 cases each. Next slide, please.
Madam Chair, can we get a copy of the presentation?
Do you have a copy now, sir, so you could submit it to us while you're doing your presentation? And also, so the Maguindanao massacre stats, you don't have it here, right?
Yes, ma'am. Hindi po namin sinama yung of these 48 work-related cases, ma'am. We count on the number of incidents and cases, so that would be additional one incident. Or we count on the number of
so
cases.
It's part of the incident.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Next slide. These are the cases that was recorded under the present administration. Of the 27 cases, Your Honor, there are 11 work-related cases, including the recent case of Rubilita Garcia. And then we have recorded 16 non-work-related cases. Five cases were piled out of the 11 work-related cases, and 14 cases were piled out of the 16 non-work-related cases. In as far as the status of the suspects, these are the arrests during on all of the cases that happened under the present administration. Total of 12 were arrested, 9 surrendered, 2 died. We have 1 conviction, and the 7 remain at large. 17 remaining suspects are at large. Next slide. On a yearly status under the present administration, from 2010 to 2014, so we can see here, Your Honor, 2013, we have recorded 6 cases, the same number of cases we got in 2003 and 2004. I think, Your Honor, that's as far as the presentation on the statistics of media practitioner. Thank you.
Do you have any questions, Senator Binay? Or maybe we can go ahead if there's any other presentation so that we can facilitate any other presentations regarding media killings. Do you have anything to add, Ms. Rowena?
Good afternoon po. I would like to apologize first for being late. Can I ask the gentleman from Task Force USIG a question? I would like to ask why the journalists who were killed in the Maguindanao massacre are not being included as among those killed in the line of duty.
Sir, please go ahead.
Actually, ma'am, Your Honor, if I'm going to show our statistics here, we have a list. We have the statistics here. It's actually included in the statistics. The statistic on the Maguindanao was separated just to emphasize as far as the number of victims and the magnitude of the number of suspects. Because in most of the 48 cases, we're talking only of one suspect and one victim for every case. Because the Maguindanao massacre was handled by a National Investigation Task Force. That was the... But in our statistics, it's It's included.
Sir, so you're talking about 48 incidents, right? Since 2001. What is your, because you presented a lot of statistics, eh? What is your percentage of success in terms of conviction? I mean, arrest leading to conviction. Do you have that statistics?
Yes, ma'am. Unfortunately, out of these 48 cases, we're only the conviction that we have is... we have 6 cases resolved with suspect conviction.
So 6 cases out of 48?
Out of 48, ma'am.
Okay. Ms. Antipoda, please go ahead.
Question, is this a conviction, does it mean it is only the gunman or the masterminds? Because what we really care about here in the National Press Club and in the Confederation of Asian Journalists is about the real culprit, which is the mastermind. Do we have any conviction of masterminds?
Unfortunately, ma'am, wala po tayong conviction ng mastermind. Just like, for example, the recent Jerry Ortega case, we all know that the alleged mastermind was still at large. In the same case with the Marlene Esperat case, the alleged mastermind was are also still at large.
Ma'am, may it be put on record that that the escape of the Ortega brothers, until now, we still don't have any development on those officials na nagpatakas, na may nakulong ba, may nakasuhan ba? Dahil mas higit pa sa mastermind yung ginawa ng mga immigration officers na nagpatakas sa mga Ortega, which alam naman natin na may hold departure order na at that time.
Okay, let's put that on record. Sir, so you're telling me that out of the 48 incidents, there's not been a mastermind convicted yet. The Ortegas have not been convicted? Not yet, right? There was just a whole departure. So none. Okay.
The Reyeses, ma'am. The Reyeses. Yung Reyes brothers po.
So that
yung one. Sa Ortega case po yun.
My question is, sir, do you have in your task force, do you have continuing education regarding evidence gathering and preservation? Because it's one of the things that I took up with one of our hearings, and I'd like to know any progress report regarding that, and how often do you conduct those?
At the end of 2010, Your Honor, we found out that out of 148,000 policemen nationwide, we only had about 1,500 trained investigators. So after 2010, we started in January 2011, up until now, we have a nationwide training for investigators. That's why we already have now, as of the moment, 13,000 from the 1,500. So we hope to come up with about 42,000 policemen who are training in investigation by the end of 2015. That's why most of the funds of the DIDM, my directorate, are channeled into the training of our policemen, because this is the complaint of our provincial director, and we are doing something about this, Your Honor.
Thank you, sir. How often do you conduct your training?
Four trainings per region in for non-officer, and then another 2 per region for 1 year per region. So now
for 1 year, continuous training? It takes 1 year to train?
No, for every class, ma'am, it's about 60 days for officers,
days.
For commissioned officers. For non-commissioned officers, about 45 days.
But this is not continuing education. This is just an initial training for possible investigators, right? Potential investigators. Walang refresher course po. Kunyari, once you're already an investigator, do you have refresher courses?
Meron po. In fact, the basic training is a criminal investigation course. And then the advanced training for this is police detective course. And then for officers, for commissioned officers, we have the investigation officer basic course. The advanced course is case management course. So that's why the officer should be trained on how to manage several investigators so that we come up with, let's say, special investigation task forces. Dapat alam ng opisyal paano i-manage ito mga ebidensya na.
Sir, here's another concern of mine. I think that there's a bill seeking to make or a proposal that if you're in the PNP, if your expertise, let's say, is administration or your expertise is investigation, that you stay in that career track so you don't get moved around. Are you familiar with this?
Yesterday, ma'am, I was in the congressional hearing on PNP modernization, and this is one of those items that were discussed. The chief PNP wants that there will be three specialties of the police: administration, investigation, and operation. Operation will be more on crime prevention, which is a basic function of the PNP, and investigation for crime solution. Administrative will be on police community relations, logistics, controllership, etc.
So administration, investigation, and operation. That's the crime prevention.
Yeah.
So you don't need a law for this, right? It's just a reorganization of the PNP?
Pending, ma'am, in the lower house is the PNP modernization.
Oh, the whole, it's lumped in the modernization.
Opo.
You cannot possibly do that without the modernization law being passed.
We need to have a law, Your Honor, because we are tied up with Republic Act 6975 amended by Republic.
So hindi pang IRR lang pala ito? Hindi pang implementing rules and regulations lang?
Hindi po, dahil naka-define po doon sa batas.
Now, you mentioned we have about 148,000 policemen all over the country. I think Secretary Rojas was encouraging, or actually he was trying to put in, he's trying to push for a program wherein you will recruit more policemen, right, under his program. How many was your target and how many have you already recruited?
I do not have the data yet, ma'am, but if I can, the SILG wanted to recruit more, but our problem in the PNP is that, let's say in one region we have a quota of 1,000, only about 300 to 400 are qualified. So in the bill that we are proposing in the lower house, we recommended that if we can recruit, Your Honor, high school graduates, but in a given time, they must, while in the service, they must graduate.
So, sir, okay, so this is what I would like to request from your office, if you can confer and ask exactly where are you in your goal, what was your goal to begin with. Did I hear it right? Like 500, I think it was 500,000 policemen by 2025. Well, anyway, if you can get that information, and we'd like to see, because clearly, I'm trying to do the math here. If we have 148,000 policemen and our population is about 103 million, clearly, we have a dearth of law enforcement individuals in our country, and we really need that. That's why one of our bills is to pass the, if you are a graduate of the K-12, you can work in the PNP, maybe as an administration personnel. Okay, so can I also hear, sir, please go ahead.
Our goal, ma'am, is to come up with a ratio of one policeman per 500 population density. And in the briefing yesterday that we had in Congress, we look until 20, at the rate we're going now, in 2025, so that we can reach that ratio of one policeman per 500 population. We will submit to you, ma'am, the data.
May I also hear a statement from the National Press Club, sir?
Thank you, Your Honor. I'd just like to react to the good general's revelation a while ago about the acute lack of investigators. Good thing that he raised that out, because actually we have observed that poor police work, sometimes sloppy police work, is among the problems in in well, even if you have filed a case already, if you have a very bad foundation case build-up, so eventually the case would be dismissed, such as in the case of Adahar in Los Baños. The suspects or suspect were released eventually because of lack of sufficient evidence and all that. But it doesn't mean that I doubt the credibility of Colonel Levi here, who has been working with us since, I think, 2006, no? But the problem is not with the national structure. I think it lies with the SITGs, the Special Investigation Task Groups. Ang problema po kasi dito, nakikita namin, pag gumalaw sila sa local, so local po ito, and then they report to the task sa USIG. So, nagkakaroon po ng time yung mga, for example, kung influential yung taong involved, no? They can influence the investigation at the lowest level. So, maaring katulad dito, nabanggit, there were mayors involved, barangay captains, policemen, some government officials, no? Or even individuals or civilians who are affluent or influential in that area. So, magkakaroon pa sila ng time to, you know, somehow throw their weight around and influence the conduct of the probe. So, what we have suggested to AO35 during our last meeting, and Colonel Levi was there also. We were with Secretary Coloma and Undersecretary Baraan. We suggested that immediately we consider all media killings work-related. So, meaning the SITG should be formed immediately, soon after the crime, with the belief that, of course, the AO35, which is an interagency body tasked to, and USIG is just part of this body, this bigger body na headed by DOJ. So ito po yung, pag nalaman nila sa SITG, na automatically we're going to consider that work-related, even if it would be proven not. So later on, so with that in mind, yung mga SITGs po, pag-uusayan nila yung investigasyon. So siguro in a span of 24 to 48 hours, dapat may linaw na. And then the AO35 prosecutors, for example, may mga state prosecutors po dito, they will begin to study the report of the SITG. Ang halaga po dito, ang nakita namin, the reason why we suggested that, is that with that in mind, andun yung kwan ng mga pulis sa ilalim na papasok ang national government dito. So we shouldn't be sloppy in handling this. We should not bungle this. Una pa lang yung case build-up po kasi talaga mahalaga eh. Kung wala makuhang suspect, wala makuhang weapon, eventually, problema. And good thing nga po, nabanggit ni General yung lack of investigators. We really need good detectives, good investigators to handle these things, lalo na yung mga ganito. Because media killings, when we go outside the country, the international community look at it as one problem. They look at it in its entirety. They do not classify whether work-related or not. So dito lang nagkakaroon ng ganun na classification. So work-related, not work-related. So we should deal with it talaga po, wholly and comprehensively. And of course, the police should, since this is in aid of legislation, the police should really do more in terms of investigation. Kasi yun po yung pagbabasihan ng kaso.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, Your Honor.
I agree that we should assume first that it's work-related, and then later on we should we can probably discount it afterwards. Now, here's a concern of mine, sir. It seems like you express confidence in the support also of Police Superintendent Levi. Sometimes when there are media killings, of course, fellow media friends, co-workers, would be very aggressive in doing the investigation. You can't, that's human nature, of course. You'd want to protect your own. You'd like to give justice to your friends and your own. Plus, it's also their responsibility. Sometimes they themselves will receive threats. And as you mentioned earlier, 19% of those that are involved are policemen, unfortunately. I think you cited it in one of your... how many cases. So clearly, sometimes the police will be involved or anybody. Do you have a special line, special secret line, a direct line to anybody, a group composed of policemen, let's say, beyond reproach, where they can have a direct line and contact? There's a threat, because you know what? It's okay if our media friends here are working in the Senate. They can come to me, they can come to Senator Nancy, and then we can call and say, and I'd like to thank General Sindak for helping us immediately and preventing something that could have been worse. So what I'm saying is, if you can have with the media, if it's a like an internal affairs office where you can call and you have a civilian also monitoring it, so that any threat by the media can be taken seriously, or at least they feel that, hindi ba ni malakas ka dito sa Cavite o malakas ka dito sa Tondo at Cavite. Pero marami naman ako mga, meron naman akong direct line sa police na pwedeng namang walang kinalaman dito sa probinsya namin. So yun lang po, maybe we can cooperate somehow to establish that, na calls will be anonymous. Of course, those that are taking advantage also of the situation, the boy who cried wolf syndrome, let's say, wala naman talagang ka-threat-threat, kalokohan lang, can be reprimanded somehow. I think the loss of his credibility would be enough. But if we can coordinate with our office, that would be nice, like a media direct line to the police. Kasi syempre, di ba, yung bulok na itlog dun sa kaing, yun lang ang nagpapasira dun sa iba, hindi naman lahat ganyan. So, you think that's possible, sir?
Yes, Your Honor. In fact, we encourage that. We have didim.pnp or pnp.gov.ph, our website, all is there. You can email, you can call, you can text.
Hindi, pero mahirap pa yung website. Pero ito, specifically assigned for, let's say, media, no? Because they're the ones that will do the reporting, eh. Let's figure something out. Maybe get somebody from the KBP to sit in as a member. Attorney Huralbal. No, anybody you can assign can work with you.
If I may add something.
Sir.
Ma'am. Thank you, Your Honor. Yes. During our previous meeting with AO35 officials, if you'd recall, Colonel Levi, there was a suggestion that the body should include at least a representative of the media. So, kasi po ang situation dito, for instance, a case of Ruby Garcia, natakot yung pamilya do sa police. That's why they came to the National Press Club. Say yun nga po yung sa investigation. So all these things add up to bigger problems, eh. Hindi sila kasi pinapipirmahan daw po sa kanila affidavit na wala namang pangalan ng suspect pa. So natakot sila. So they came to the NPC, so through the generosity of our vice president here, sila po yung nagtago. Yes, puro bono na ito. And kahapon we turned them over to the WPP. So may ganun pong mga problems, no? That's why, sabi nga namin, yung AO35, please correct me if I'm wrong, sirs, ang sabi namin, pagpasok ng body na ito, kaya matatakot ang mga SITG na lokohin yung investigasyon dahil may mediang representative. Whoever they may be, kasama sila ng mga investigators na papasok mismo doon.
Pakiulit nga po, ano yung AO35?
Yes, it's an interagency body composed of the DOJ, NBI, PNP, of course, the task force, and yun lang yata.
What is the goal of the AO35?
Maybe Colonel Levi can expound on AO35 po.
Attorney, go ahead, please.
Oh, yes.
I'd like to acknowledge your presence, Attorney Arminia Angeles of the Department of Justice.
Afternoon, Madam Chair. Sorry for being late because we just came from the 6th interagency meeting of the AO35 at the DILG. What is AO35? The Administrative Order Number 35 is it entitled Creating the Interagency Committee on Extrajudicial Killings and Forced Disappearances, Torture and Other Grave Violation of the Rights to Life, Liberty, and Security of Persons. It is composed of bodies chaired by the Department of Justice, such as DILG, Office of the Peace Process, Office of the Presidential Human Rights Committee, the OPAPA, the PNP, the Armed Forces of the Philippines and the AFP Human Rights Office. The Commission on Human Rights and Ombudsman sit as observers. Under the AO 35, we have these operational guidelines, series 2012, wherein we defined what are the cases that would fall under extrajudicial killings, which is quite perennial, because for the torture and the enforced disappearances, there will be no problem because we have laws on it. But for EJK, we identified that the victim was either a member of or affiliated with an organization to include political, environmental, agrarian, labor, or similar causes, or an advocate of above-named causes, or a media practitioner, or a person apparently mistaken or identified to be so. The victim was targeted and killed because of his or her actual or perceived membership, advocacy, or profession. That's why it was correct to say that a while ago that, for example, a media person was killed, automatically it is presumed to be EJK, but that will be subject to the determination of the technical working group which was created under the operational guidelines. Me and my colleague here, Attorney Luz, are part of this technical working group, and we were together with the PN, with the Task Force USIG, members of the Task Force USIG, OPAP, Presidential Human Rights Committee, DILG, NBI, are members of this TWG and CHR, where we try to analyze whether the case is really media related or the a media person was killed for some other personal purpose, such as lover's quarrel or land grabbings like that. And then we submit this to the IAC for the final approval. Who are the members of the IAC? They are the secretary and the cabinet members of all these agencies involved. The person responsible for the killing happens to be a state agent or non-state agent, and the method and circumstances of the attack reveal a deliberate intent to kill.
Attorney, may I cut you off, Justin? Yes. Please provide me a copy of the functions of or the goals of AO 35. Who will be the implementing body here? Who will be the head?
The head is Secretary of Justice, Secretary De Lima.
So this is the main goal of this one is for prosecution.
Not only prosecution, but investigation. Under the AO 35, there are several composite teams created. The Special Investigation Team for New Cases, or the SITN, the Special Investigation Team for Existing Current Cases, or the CTEC, the Special Investigation Teams for Unsolved Cases, or the C2.
Okay, so this is new, basically, this AO.
This AO is not, I would not say that this is really new, because before there is Task Force 211, also under the Department of Justice. But this AO 35 is something different because it covers all. As for example,
so when did you come up with this AO 35? When did you organize this?
It was organized sometime in 2011, because we were called by we submitted our report to US. And they ask about extrajudicial killings.
May we ask for a summarized progress report?
Yes,
we can also understand your work. Now, I have to go back to sir. I'll go back to you. But you think it would be best to be under this particular group, the direct line to the police?
Because all these groups that we have that I have mentioned are composed of prosecutors and investigators.
Do you have a secretariat with a direct line?
Yes, Madam Chair.
We'll think about the expediency of that. Mr. Antipoda, go ahead, please.
Yeah, may isa sample lang ho ko na kaso, no? Which is the Jensen case. Nakalimutan ko lang yung pangalan ng reporter na napatay doon. Which is, ang nag-investigate is the local police of General Santos, no? At ang nangyari po is, nagkaroon ng hindi magandang investigasyon. And immediately, at that time, yung Task Force 211 took over and narelieve kaagad yung hepe doon. Kasi po ang involved dito is police, which is yung Inspector Acharon, if I'm not wrong, no? And this police is close also to the politicians in Jensen. So ngayon po, sa nakikita po namin sa investigasyon dito sa mga nangyayaring patayan, gaya dito kay Ruby Garcia, ang isinisigaw po nung namatay is may involvement ang isang pulis. Bakit pulis ang nag-iimbestiga sa kanya, which is the local police of Cavite, yung provincial police office, na ang salita po ng pulis sa kanya, ituro mo na lang yan. Tapos yung reward, basta bigyan nyo na lang to, ito titestigo naman para sa atin. So, napakapangit, ipakukulong mo yung isang taong walang kasalanan para lang magkaroon ng accomplishment. Then, at the same time, may ipinipilit sila na itong dalawang to ang pumatay. Ang sabi ng bata, hindi yan ang pumatay. Hindi ko nakita yan. Ito, maari pa, itong isa, tinuturo, nililigaw naman siya at sinasabing hindi natin pwede ituro yan kasi ganito yan, ganoon yan. So, naguguluhan po kami, hindi po ba tama, no, na sa atin, since ang involved e police, eh sana naman MBI ang pinadala ng gobyerno para mag-imbestiga. Or dati po, ang pinadadala po kasi ng Task Force 211, eh yung prosecutors talaga mismo nag-iimbestiga. At sila yung nagsasabi na tama o mali yung takbo ng investigasyon kasi oh, sila yung prosecutors. Hindi ho namin nakikita ngayon to eh.
Okay, salamat. Thank you for raising that, Mr. Antipoda. Attorney, katulad nga dun sa case ni Ms. Garcia sa Cavite, anong ginawa ng grupo ninyo? Kayo ba ay meron ng hakbang para maimbestigahan ng hindi naman pulis ng Cavite para mas maging patas ang investigasyon? Meron na bang tumawag sa inyo? Yun nga yung sinasabi ko, yung direct line eh, para makapagsumbong eh.
Ma'am, personal po, pinuntahan ko po yung AO35, kasama po ang ating Pangulo si Joel Egco. Personal po kami lumapit, pero in return po, kami ho yung nagpa-follow up eh. Hindi ho namin trabaho to eh, civilian kami, trabaho ho ng gobyerno to na mag-follow up sa amin.
The case is already with the DOJ and there has been created a special investigation team. Remember, what you are saying is during the time of the past administration, that is Task Force 211. This is a different one because, as I said, the...
Kaya nga, attorney, so dapat mas mabilis. Kasi nga, sinasabi niya, nung 211 may action, ngayon wala.
Wala ba? Okay. But right now, it is also correct that the investigators is composed of the PNP and the NBI. So I don't have any personal knowledge or I'm not privy that if there's a case happens to be, the perpetrator happens to be a police, it is also the policeman that is investigating the case. Because as far as we know, the SIT is composed of NBI, prosecutors, and police.
Ma'am, may I request that when you have another organizational meeting, or perhaps since we are heading the Public Order Committee in the Senate, that you send that we will send a representative from us just to oversee the function of this AO35 to make sure that there's an easy way to get in touch with you. Kasi your intentions are great, and I'm so happy that you have this. But it doesn't matter if your response is delayed because you're trying to cover all legal aspects. There are certain things that time is of the essence, especially when there's a threat against the life of a media practitioner or any individual. I'd like to acknowledge the son of Ruby Garcia. He's in the Senate today. His name is Tristan. He is in the Witness Protection Program, but I decided not to call him in today anymore because he's only 12 years old. I can just have a...
No, matured po si Tristan. Yung bata po, yung anak niya, yung po yung minor de edad. Si Tristan po, ano na yan? Adult na ho yan, yung father.
Okay, before I call for a one-minute suspension to call him, so there's another child that's younger than the 12-year-old. That definitely I don't think we should call. We only have 15 minutes left for this particular concern.
Ma'am,
we have
additional.
To move to cybercrime. But, sir.
In fairness ka pala sa DOJ, pangit naman, no, kung hindi natin, ano, after 30 plus days, na-approve naman yung witness protection program na kinuha na nila yung pamilya Garcia after 1 month po.
Hindi kaya nga, hindi, okay lang, sir, because we're learning from each time we have some problem, we have to be able to learn from it. And I'm confident now that they will be able to act faster in this situation. Let's coordinate para there's one person. Kasi ma'am, if you find out, hindi naman pala kailangan sa witness protection to eh, edi alisin ka agad. Diba? Pero yung mahirap nun, yung after 30 days, you determine witness protection eligible, patay na. Diba? Yun yung mas masakit. So let's just work faster. And I thank you for having such a encyclopedic knowledge of your functions. If we can just lay it out in practical, usable terms so that we can really benefit from it. Thank you, Attorney. Attorney Joralbal, ma'am, just...
Good afternoon, ma'am. Good afternoon, everybody. Just to share some experiences in Task Force USIG and 211, which might bear on how AO35 operates. For example, the issue of the police investigating when the police have been involved. I think we should look into the manual of operating procedures because the default is the local police does the investigation. And only if there is a manual of procedure stating otherwise will the default move aside. Because there's no other way except the local police taking over investigation in case an incident happens. As to, in fact, last week we had a meeting with members of the media, and we were wondering what this super body was all about, this AO35. A body which was supposed to be doing something in our behalf, we did not know anything about it. The point is, our experience in USIG and 211 is we were involved there. We sat down with them, we gave our inputs, we gave our information, and we were able to get feedback. Sometimes the frustration when we saw in Task Force USIG in 211 was the feedback mechanism was poor. For example, we felt that certain things were not being done, but when we met in the monthly meeting, we were informed of the progress. So the feedback is also important because the families of the victims come to us, the organizations, and we have to give them information. So to summarize, Madam Chair, one is the manual of procedures for the PNP must look into the default action, especially in these cases. Number two, participation in all of these bodies involved in the killings of media and a feedback mechanism, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your very constructive suggestion, sir. Ma'am, who do you have representing the media in your group?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just would like to answer all. For your request for representation, we will submit this to the Secretary of Justice, and you are very welcome to be part of, or to be at least observer. At least you know what we are doing.
Not me directly, but somebody from...
Yes, ma'am. But of course, we're happy that we are in coordination also with your committee. For on issue on investigation that was raised by our friend here, that is a very good point. But and HR from the PNP, from the AFP, from the OPAP, and the TWG and the IAC.
Number one, magsuot ng gloves if kung meron. Kung wala, maghawak ng panyo o plastic bag. Number two, wag tapak-tapangan. You know, very, ano, kung meron kayong cellphone, gamitin ninyo, kumuha ng litrato. At tumawag sa numerong ito para sumunod ang formal investigation. There's certain things that are just practical. In the meantime, that our structure is not yet in place. This is just a suggestion. If you can follow that, let's have more meetings. Kasi medyo na ano ko yung public order dahil puro FOI eh. So ngayon, do you have any questions?
Madam Chair? Yeah,
yes, ma'am.
One question. In terms of meron na ho ba kayong in place? Kunyari, there's a media personnel na may threat na tapos nagsumbong sa police. Do you provide them with security or iniimbisigahan niyo ba yung mga may potential nga na gustong pumatay sa kanila? Kasi I think dapat din isipin natin na yung preventive measures eh. Kasi we've been talking yung after the fact, kumbaga namatay na yung media personnel. Siguro dapat pagbutihan din natin yung preventive measures.
Yes, Your Honor. In fact, we have created specifically the PSPG, the Police Security and Protection Group, purposely to, because of this. May mga reports po, pag napunta sa amin, pag-report yung isang tao, not necessarily media practitioners, kahit sino, then binibigyan po natin ng security. In fact, our PSPG now is, I think, 7,000 strong.
Pero may instance ho ba na nahuli na kayo na kasi pinagplanuhan nila na patayin yung isang reporter? Meron ho bang case na ganun?
With regard, ma'am, for the protective drawing, there are also instances that the media practitioner do not want to avail of the protection for whatever reason. So what we just did was the conduct of mobile patrol operation on the
to conceal the face of the child. So
our members, for example, in the NPC, we received, they sent, because of the intervention of the Madam Chair here, the police was able to do something about this case. No, parang he was under direct information so that people, other people, concerned people can act immediately. And,
yeah, and I'd like to thank General Sindak for that quick action. We need somebody powerful, somebody in place like him to be able to direct an order like that immediately.
Yes.
Okay, Senator Pimentel.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I heard earlier a proposal that if the police is suspected to be involved in a
pagsumbong all the way, just to, for it to act, is just not sustainable over time. It has to be a workable system. And having this in mind, whether we call it at STIGG, whatever task force, drafts already on chain of custody issues without having to train 40,000, 80,000. That's already embedded. But because of our archaic system dating back to the Spanish colonial regime, we still have this police-led effort, and they have to compile legal standards which they would not be properly equipped with to meet the standards of probable cause, and beyond that, proof beyond reasonable doubt. The better practice internationally is to fuse already the investigative prosecutorial work. We're the only country left in the world that still maintains a firewall between the investigators and the prosecutors, as if they're not supposed to talk to each other. They can't work together because certain judicial, quasi-judicial, and legal roadblocks that we have set over the past 80, 90 years. And we have a pending bill, which is already with the good senator, that will revolutionize, transform this aspect. So we immediately solve this long problem of policemen not knowing the legal standards, you know, for your...
What bill is that, sir?
It's a criminal investigation bill that we have.
With it's with your committee, Senator Pimentel, or with mine?
Having it checked, Chair.
Yes, ma'am. And this will be transformational in terms of solving this at one go. You don't have to give advice on wearing gloves and hand keys for policemen, who should actually be basic for investigators and prosecutors. The last point, ma'am, is during the first year of the Pinoy administration, we conducted our first justice summit, which actually assessed all the systemic holistic approach, not on the per case basis because it's in the headlines, but a very fundamental approach to it. One of them is our criminal code reform. One of them would be new rules on criminal procedure, which is proceeding with the Supreme Court, and a host of other issues. All the problems have been mapped. Studies after studies have already shown the poor investigative capacity, the lack of conviction, the weakness in the judicial system, the susceptible to integrity issues. All of them have been mapped. The solutions are already there. It's a matter of getting them done. So we would like to table this for your committee's kind consideration, because justice cannot wait another day for another law to be passed, to find out that law is not adequate, for training for the next 10, 20 years, that it's not sustainable over time. It has to require a 21st century thinking for a problem that we have inherited since the founding of the Republic. Thank you, ma'am.
Wow, that is quite an informative, actually a very nice summary of what we're discussing here today. Indeed, what we're doing right now are Band-Aid solutions. So, but we also need to have a timely action to whatever situation confronts us. So in the meantime, we have to be able to build those systems in. However, you're right, a holistic systemic approach is necessary, and I hope to be able to help you with this bill that you're proposing to make justice more to make justice accessible to everyone immediately in the shortest possible time. Sir.
Madam Chairperson, ASEC C mentioned the Justice Summit with the results. Maybe you can provide the two committees with the results of the Justice Summit. Both our committees.
Which I'm sure you will expertly explain to me. Thank you. Now, we have here the son of Ruby Garcia. He's here with us today. Unang-una sa ating sa anak ni Ruby Garcia, si Tristan. Hindi yan ang tunay niyang pangalan. Yan. Tunay niyang pangalan. Okay, wag na ninyong i-report. Oh, kung hindi pa ninyo nare-report. Gayun pa man, kung ano man yung kasunduan tungkol dyan, nais kong makiramay sayo, sa inyong pinagdaanan. Okay. Ang pwede mong gawin ngayon, at ako'y natutuwa sa iyong kagitingan para sa iyong nanay, para mabigyan ng hustisya ang kanyang kamatayan. Pakisabi naman kung ano yung iyong naranasan tungkol dito para kung anong pwede nating gawin para maresolbahan itong kasong ito ay magawa natin. Hindi lamang para sa nanay mo, kundi para sa mga iba pang nanay na nasa media, iba pang tatay, at sigurado magpapasalamat sa iyo. Kung meron ka ng gustong umpisahan.
Magandang hapon po. Ano po ma'am, kasi po ma'am, halos 44 days na po yung pagkamatay po ni mami. Binigay po namin ma'am dun sa police yung ano yung investigation. Pero nung una pa lang po, gusto ko po sana NBI po talaga kasi po. Yung nabanggit po sa akin ng mami ko, parang police po kasi siya. So parang hindi ko po maano na, pero kahit ganun pa man po, binigyan pa rin po namin ng benefit of the doubt yung mga ano, kinaukulan po. Kaso po, until now po, parang ano po eh, wala pong ano, tapos parang kami po yung may kasalanan po. Tapos ma'am, ano po, nung nagtatago po kami sa tiyahin ko po, ano po ma'am, yung mga ginagawa po ng mga ano, kapulisan po sa amin, parang hindi po namin gusto talaga kasi andun po yung may pinatuturo po sila, pero hindi naman po yung talagang tinuturo po ng nakakita. Tapos dumating pa po sa point ma'am na yung reward po, parang yung tinuturo nila, bigyan na lang daw po namin yung ano, yung tinuturo nila. Pero, kaya yun po, parang lalong tumibay po yung loob ko na parang hindi po dapat sa pulis to. Parang, kaya po.
Well, Tristan, yun bang nung nangyari sa nanay mo yun, may nakakita pero hindi ikaw? Sino, huwag mabanggitin ang pangalan, pero ang nakakita ba'y kapitbahay mo, naglalakad doon, babae, lalaki?
Ano po? Bata po siya.
Bata. Opo. Ngayon yung bata na yon, na-describe ba niya sa'yo o na...
Opo ma'am, kasi po nakita niya po talaga ma'am yung bumaril po kay mami, pati yun po yung bang, kasama po.
Yung bumaril ba sa nanay mo, siya din ang... Siya ba yung binanggit ng nanay mo na...
Hindi ko po alam ma'am, kasi hindi ko rin po kilala ma'am yung binanggit po ng mother ko po ma'am talaga eh.
Pero sabi mo may batang nakakita.
Opo.
Huwag natin muna banggitin yung pangalan, no? Yung pulis na yon, yung chief na yon, siya rin ba yung nakita ng bata?
Hindi po, ma'am.
Iba? So, meron na pag-utusan kung sakasakali?
Hindi ko rin po, ano, siguro po, ma'am.
So, nung binanil ang nanay mo, tumakbo ka doon, kaya mo siya naabutan? Ganun ba yon?
Nasa bahay rin po ako ng ma'am, kasal ko yan po, nasa rooftop po ako ng bahay namin. Tapos nung may narinig po akong putok, sumilip po ako dun sa may ano, rooftop po namin papunta sa harapan ng bahay. Nakita ko po yung bata na nagsisisigaw, umiiyak, nagpapapadyak po. Bumaba po agad ako. Tapos nakita ko nga po yung mami ko po. Tapos tinawag niya po ako. Tapos binuot ko po siya agad. Tapos may nakita po kung ano, yung butas po sa ano, katawan niya. Tapos yun nga po. Dumalas po yung kamay ko sa likod niya pag abot ko. Tapos tinakbo ko po siya dun sa ano, iskinita namin. Dinala ko po agad sa ospital po.
Ilang taon na yung nanay mo nung namaya pa siya?
Ano po, 52 na po.
52. Ngayon, basta may nabanggit siyang pangalan sa'yo.
Opo ma'am.
Sabi niya yun yun. Ngayon, bago niya nabanggit yung pangalan niya, pag kayo ba'y kumakain ng nanay mo, nagkukwentuhan kayo kasama yung pamilya, may nababanggit pa siya tungkol dito na sinasabi niya na salbahe talaga yon, o iniimbestigahan ko yon, o nagbabanta sa akin yon?
Wala po, mami. Wala po.
Ngayon, sa pag-aaral mo dahil nga dun sa nabanggit sa'yo ng nanay mo, ano bang nasabi sa'yo ng mga kaibigan ng nanay mo? Iniimbestigahan ba niya itong mamang ito?
Ano po nga, yung nagkaroon po sila ng pagtatalo po nung ano, bago po siya mamatay. Kasi nag-courtesy call po siya dun sa station. Kaso, nabastos po siya nung ano, nung happy po. Tapos yun po, nung linggo po kasi siya binaril po eh. Nung Sabado po, niradyo niya po yung nangyari sa kanila.
Tapos,
bakit siya pumunta dun sa, ito hindi na galing sa nanay mo, ito sa pag-aaral mo pagkatapos dun sa nangyari, no? Bakit siya pumunta dun sa stasyon? Alam ko na lathala ito sa dyaryo, pero gusto kong marinig sa'yo. Bakit siya pumunta dun sa Hepe?
Kasi po nga dapat pupunta po sila ng birthday dun po sa, ano, sa area po ng, ano, ng lugar na po na yun. Bali, nag-courtesy ko lang po sila na nandun po sila para kung ano't ano man po yung mangyari. May alam po yung ano, parang ganun po siya, ma'am. Tapos, tatlo po silang ano, national, ano po, national na magkakasama po.
So, may birthday party dun sa...
Sa lugar po na yan.
Opo. Ng Hepe?
Hindi po. Dun po sa area po nung ano, nung nakinasasakupan po nung Hepe. Isang barangay po dun.
So, pumunta siya dun sa party, tapos lumapit siya sa Hepe?
Hindi po. Bali, dumaan muna po siya ng police station.
Oo.
Na yun nga po, na andun po sila sa area. Tapos pagkatapos po nun, yun nga po, nagkaroon po sila ng ano.
Bakit siya kinailangan dumaan ng police station? Parang weird naman yun, may party sa barangay, tapos dadaan muna ako ng police station ng barangay na yun bago pumuntang party.
Ganun po kasi nun yung usual yung ginagawa po nila, mami, kapag ano po, kapag papasyal po sila sa isang city or municipality.
Meron ba siyang iniimbestigahan dito sa police na to? Kaya siya pumunta doon para sabihan na iniimbestigahan kita sa ganito?
Sa pagkakalam ko po, wala po, mami.
Anong sinabi niya doon sa kanyang radio station tungkol dito sa pulis na to? Bastos siya? Hindi niya ako
inarap? Kinuwento niya lang daw po yung nangyari po.
Ano yung nangyari?
Yun nga po, yung pagdating po nila, nagpinag-antay po sila nung ano nung, kasi may ka-meeting daw po. Pumunta po sa kanila yung secretary po yata yun ng ano nung Hepe po, babae. Tapos pinaalam po dun sa Hepe na ano may mga ano nga po bisita sila po. Tapos po pinagantay po sila, tapos nagantay po sila. Tapos sabi po hindi daw sila kilala. Tapos sabi po ni Mami, magpapakilala daw sila. Kumbaga ganun po. Tapos kung hindi daw po sila talaga kilala, magpapakilala daw po sila. Tapos po yun po. Bumalik po ulit, tapos yun po parang ano po, sinabi po talaga nung Hepe na ano po, yung hindi nga po daw nila kilala talaga. Hindi ko po alam yung talagang words na ginamit, yung pagpananalita po. Pero ganun po yung flow ng story po.
Madam Chair, kung in-air niya to sa radio program the Saturday before she was killed, no? I'm sure nakatape ito. Tama ba? Is that the practice, Attorney Hularbal? Nakatay po ba yung mga ganyang komentaryo? So, kasi hindi rin alam ng ating testigo yung paano kunento ng mama niya on air. Eh. So, kung yun ang tanong, yun ang gusto natin malaman, so maybe there should be a tape. Tama po ba yan? Can you use the mic, sir?
Normally, there would be, but we're only required to keep it for 10 days.
What reasons would compel you to preserve the tape for more than 10 days? Kung may nagreklamo or something? Pag wala, i-destroy na?
Depende sa station yun, sir. But generally, we preserve it if there's an order from the National Telecommunication to preserve it.
Siguro, Madam Chair, let's just find out which station and then find out kung may tape. Kasi hindi yata alam na witness yung how it was really relayed on air. Eh, no? Ano?
Sige pa, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Senator Pimentel. Hindi mo kita pwedeng tawagin anak. So, Mr. Garcia, ganito lamang yun. Kaya ako tinatanong lahat ng detalye. Kahit anuman ang dahilan sa pagpatay sa iyong nanay, ay mali. Dahil ang pagpatay ay mali. Hindi yan ay kriminal. Subalit gusto rin natin malaman yung mga ibang nadadawit dito. Katulad niyan, kahit media pa tayo, kahit sang-ayon tayo sa media, syempre may karapatan ng lahat ng tao, pati yung mga pulis. So kung ang pangalan ng Hepe o kung sino man ay nadadamay dito, gusto natin malaman kung meron bang totoong motibasyon para gawin niya yon. Kasi kung siya ay napintasan sa isang radio program, kasi kami palagi din kami pinipintasan, pero hindi yun masyadong malaking dahilan para pumatay ka. So gusto natin malaman kung ito ba'y maaaring siya nga gumawa o may iba pang, lalo na ang nanay mo ay sa media. Hindi lamang yung Hepe na yan, maaaring merong iba pa, maaaring drugs, hindi natin alam. So gusto natin malaman, gusto namin ikaw tulungan. Pero ang gusto rin natin ay balansehin ang karapatan ng mga ibang maaaring nasangkot dito na hindi naman sila basta-basta madudumihan ang pangalan nila. So, unang-una, salamat sa iyong pagpunta dito na nalinawan yan para malaman din ng mga kapatid ng nanay mo sa hanap buhay na meron silang maitutulong sa pag-imbestiga, halimbawa kung may alam sila. Pero hihingin ko sa stasyon ng nanay mo kung meron kang kilala doon o kung sino man ang pwede nating DWAD ba? DWAD. Hingi tayo ng kopya. Siguro naman kung talagang sa tingin nila may kadahilanan para mangyari yun sa nanay mo, itatago nila yung tape na yan. Pero syempre, provincial station. So we really can't assume that they have it. So hihingin natin yan. Ang ginagawa natin...
Ma'am, national po yun. Yung DWAD. National po yun. Station.
Pasensya na. So hingi tayo ng kopya nun. Mas lalo pang dapat may kopya sila. So ginagawa natin ito. Hindi na natin may babalik ang buhay ng nanay mo. Pero ang ginagawa mong ito ay nagbibigay ng tulong sa mga iba pang katulad mo para wag mangyari sa kanila ito.
Opo, ma'am.
So, rest assured, no? Ito yung aking ano sa'yo, na gawa natin ang paraan para hindi mangyari sa ibang media. Ngayon, may mga kapatid ka ba? Ikaw bang panganay?
Ako na lang po, ma'am.
Only child ka?
Opo, ma'am.
May tatay ka?
Wala na rin po.
Sino nag-aalaga sa'yo?
Yung tita ko na lang po. Tsaka po si Sir Benny po.
Ikaw ulit. Nung nagpunta yata ako sa event niyo, parang ang dami na ninyong inaalagaan. Alam mo, napakaswerte mo na nakatagpo ka ng katulad ni Mr. Antiporda. Yun nga, maganda rin magkaroon ng trust yung media, no? Parang trust fund para sa mga ganyan. Subalit sige, meron ka pa bang gustong idagdag?
Yung nasabi po ni Mami nung ano po, nasa cellphone niya din po yun, Mami. Under custody po ng police po yun ngayon.
Ano yung nasa cellphone?
Yun po, yung nangyari po nung ano, narinig din po doon ng tita ko nung pinarinig po sa kanya nung ano, nag-meeting po sila.
Ang ibig mo sabihin, ni-record ng nanay mo, ang conversation niya doon sa police?
May kausap po yata siya, tapos kinukwento niya po yung ano nangyari. Ganun po.
Kinikwento niya, ni-record sa cellphone ng nanay mo?
Opo.
Pero hindi niya ni-record yung... hindi.
Sa calls po yata yun, ma'am.
Ha?
Parang may kausap po siya, tapos yung...
Ah, so yung sinabi niya pumatay sa kanya ang naka-record?
Hindi yung nangyari po nung sa police station po.
Okay, let's get this clear. May kausap ang nanay mo sa telepono na naka-record? Or nakikipag-usap siya at nire-record?
Hindi ko... Kasi po, di po ba sa ano yung parang... Hindi ko po matiyak kung naka-record siya or... Yun yung nakuha nung sa police po sa cyber po yata yun na... Yung mga... Makukuha nila yung mga text kahit nabura na po. Yung mga calls, parang ganun po.
Sige, kunin na lang natin yung mga detalye na yon. Kasi, at saka talagang kailangan marinig yung commentary ng nanay mo para malaman natin kung may sapat na basihan. Pero talagang, sinasabi ko, maraming pwedeng tumira. Pero hindi naman sapat na dahilan yon para pumatay agad kasi mas sasama ang sitwasyon. Pero mali yung nangyaring yon sa nanay mo. Kaya kailangan marisolbahan natin dahil baka ibang kaso niya eh. Hindi ito ngayon. Gayon pa man, dahil wala kayong tiwala at maaaring ang suspecha ninyo ay pulis, yun nga ang ating inaayos na struktura sa pag-iimbestiga, na sana yung mga kumikaso yung pulis o hinala sa pulis, iba yung mag-imbestiga or merong isang independent group na kasama yung pulis. Siyempre, we don't want naman to infringe on your I guess, duties.
Chairperson, para siguro masiguro na hindi ma-drop itong issue nito pagpatay kay Rubilita Garcia, siguro for the record, sabihin sa atin ng PNP, sino ang in charge dito sa investigation ng kaso niya? Pangalan at para for the record.
Right now, Your Honor, the head of the task force, special investigation task force is Police Senior Superintendent Joselito Chudoro Esquivel Jr. the provincial director of Cavite.
Okay, so if he should be changed in the future, that this committee, as well as my committee, the Justice Committee, be informed of the changes.
Yes, sir.
If ever. Para hindi po natin nalilimutan na ang issue na ito at sino ang dapat responsible police official who should know everything about the case. Yung po, kaya ko kinukuha yung pangalan, because he should know everything about the case. Siya in charge.
That's a very good suggestion, Senator. I think that may we request, together with the other requests we stated so far, a report from Mr. Esquivel on the investigation thus far, the ones that he can provide us with, and the ones that you can provide the Mr. Antipoda, who's acting as the guardian. Or maybe not. To us, and then we'll just meet with them.
WPP.
Your Honor, after this, we can give you a copy of the synopsis of the case.
Thank you, sir.
Three angles on this.
Oh, okay, that's
the number one is, of course, the police officer who was immediately relieved. And there are two other angles to the case. We can provide this to you, sir.
Oh, okay, thank you, sir. Of course, it's good that the policeman took a leave at this time, but relieved. So there is a probable cause for him to have been...
No, ma'am, because he was mentioned, his name was mentioned when the victim was being brought to the hospital.
But just, I mean, it's not that I'm trying to belittle the testimony of a dying person. It's just that if that happens to anybody, policeman or not, and then you're relieved from your post, there should be compelling evidence. So are you saying that there is, aside from the testimony of the dying person?
That is, ma'am, the evidence that we have, because may statement na blank the name. Meron akong binanatan sa dyaryo na Hepe sa Tansa. So immediately the chief PNP ordered his administrative relief. Because okay. He may be involved in the case.
I'd like to respect everyone's rights here. So I will look at this fairly and see. Now, before we move on to our next hearing on cybercrime, I'd like to summarize the following. Number one, my suggestion for a direct line for media practitioners that we can talk about this so that if there are any threats by the police, by the PNP, then they feel that they have some sort of protection. Number two, I need an update on the number of police you have recruited so far in the program that you have to increase the number of policemen in our streets. Number three, I need the membership representation of AO35 and a progress so far of what you've done, and also if you can put somebody from media to coordinate with you. And then number four, the procedure for the manual of procedures for regular police officers for evidence gathering, etc., if you have that. And then, of course, the report by Esquivel regarding the case. Let me remind you, I think there was a survey done and Senator Soto mentioned to me. They asked Filipinos about what is their primary concern nowadays. And supposed to be, it's not the PDAF issue, although it is an issue. The number one concern of Filipinos today is not crime, hunger. It's crime. Number one apparently is crime. It was mentioned to us. Number two is health. Number three is education. So we really are forced to act on this immediately. If our countrymen feel that crime is the number one concern that they have, then there has to be a reason why. So let's now move on. First, I'd like to thank all the resource people for this particular hearing on media killings. For our media practitioners, we thank you for being here, for your courage also, but we ask for your patience. I know. They've probably asked this a million times. But in trying to respect everyone's rights, we'd want to make sure that we don't violate others' rights as well when we're trying to uphold justice for somebody. And also to the son of Ms. Garcia, Tristan, maraming salamat sa iyong paglahok ngayon. Ipagdadasal ka namin at ipagdasal mo rin kami na gawin namin ang tama ang aming trabaho para mabigyan din ng hustisya ang nanay mo.
Salamat po, ma'am.
Attorney Huralbal, thank you as always, and everybody from the NUJP, at from the DOJ, thank you for your participation today. You may still join us if you want, but we're going to move on to cybercrime. So are there any presentations on cybercrime? We're hearing here the proposed bill of Senator Legarda. But I think Attorney Huralbal, you should stay for the cybercrime.
Yes, ma'am. We were invited for cybercrime.
For that also. Yes, and Chief of Cybercrime Division, NBI, you have a presentation, sir, or just here to answer questions or a brief statement?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just a statement, Your Honor, and we will submit our position paper, Your Honor, on the discussed bills. And for the record, Your Honor, for the Cybercrime Division of NBI, since January of this year, we've been conducting investigations on the cybercrime incidents in the country. In fact, we had already 13 search warrants in which most of these cases have been filed in court. And to date, we had about 29 people who are still in jail for violation of the child pornography law. There's a ongoing hearing, Your Honor, on the cases that we are having, Your Honor. So we will be submitting, Your Honor, to the committee a report on these cases as well as our position on the bills that will be discussed, Your Honor.
Sir, can I ask you if you're familiar, how many do you have, how many personnel do you have in your cybercrime division? I always ask this, I keep forgetting.
Currently, Your Honor, we have 13 investigators, Your Honor, and 3 forensic examiners, Your Honor.
13 investigators. Who are manning your computers? I mean, you know, to do the search.
The investigators, Your Honor, are the one manning the computers, Your Honor.
Madam Chair, just to add to your question, in terms of equipment, well-equipped to ba yung cybercrime division?
We have equipments, Your Honor, and the same time, Your Honor, the good Senator Legarda gave us some funding for this year, and we are in the process of procuring some of our equipment, both for the investigation and for the forensic examination of this digital evidence, Your Honors.
Yes, please submit your budget to increase the number of personnel for your cybercrime division and also your computers or whatever else you need. You submitted that for 2015, not yet, right?
We did, Your Honor. It's actually incorporated in our proposed
finance,
budget.
Finance.
It was submitted to the Department of Budget, Your Honor, but we will submit to the Finance Committee of the Senate, Your Honor.
You have to meet with us, also with our group, to make sure that we have that in place. I don't know, it's okay, because the Finance Committee will... Excuse me, sir. Thank you, sir.
Your Honor, just to add, there was a department order from the Secretary of Justice to increase our manpower, and in fact, we are in the process of recruiting or looking for the right person within the agency to be transferred to our office. In fact, the department order also orders us to create our regional cybercrime center. One in Mindanao, one in Visayas, and another one in Luzon, Your Honor.
Diba to become an NBI agent, you have to be, number one, a lawyer or an accountant? Tama ba yon o mali?
Yes, Your Honor. The law that we have, which is way back in 1936, says that to be an agent, you have to be a lawyer, a CPA. But then they open another item, which is a special investigator item, wherein any four-year course with the civil service eligibility can enter, Your Honor.
Because there are a lot of kids who will be the perfect investigator for this. I mean, to do cyber search. would probably not have the normal qualifications, but can you get them on not as a career track for the NBI, but to do some research also for you? Would you hire? Would you be able to have that authority to hire extra help that's not necessarily NBI personnel? Outsourcing.
We will look into it, Your Honor, but I think that would be a good idea, Your Honor.
Kasi mag-outsource kayo ng investigation. Like if you have, di ba may BPO, and then there's also expert process outsourcing. Ibig sabihin, it's not just about answering phones. It's also about giving some expertise. If you can hire a company, then you don't have to pay the benefits of those particular... No, this is just being practical because your resources are not unlimited. So to hire a separate company, a private company, and contract them out to do the preliminary research, the lead which you can follow. So this is just a suggestion. Can you look into it? Can you ask your bosses to explore that?
Yes, Your Honor.
Possibility. Okay. Protective Services Bureau, ma'am, do you have anything, a statement to add?
Okay. Good afternoon, Madam Chair. The DSWD, we're still finalizing our position paper. But you know, the DSWD now is, we are providing services for those victims that are temporarily housed in our Home for Girls and even Marilac Hills in our residential care facilities.
How many do you have in your care right now? Because it's directly related to cybercrime.
Actually, we have 177 cases, and these are from 2010 up to the present. And we have Region 7, who was the highest, 57. And this is followed up by Region 3, 25 cases. And then we have NCR, 15. So these cases, some of these cases are now returned to their families, reintegrated to their families, but there are also cases who are with ongoing court cases that are being handled or cared by the DSWD or sa aming mga partner non-government agencies accredited and licensed by the DSWD, ma'am.
Do you have any facilities for them in particular?
We okay. have the Home for Girls. And then for NCR here in Metro Manila, we have the Marilac Hills.
Do you have counseling available for these kids?
Yeah. Once the client is being accepted in our residential facilities, basic provisions will be provided to them. And then counseling services. And then we also give them free legal services through our social workers who are in our residential care facilities.
Madam Chair?
Yes, yes, Senator.
You mentioned on the reintegration with their families. Kasama din ho dito yung magulang mismo yung nagpapagawa dun sa mga bata ng cybersex.
Yung katulad po, in case for Region 7, base doon sa aming regional office, mga nanay po nila ang mismong nagano nito mga batang ito. So the parents are now behind bars pa. So, wala pa because lately lang yung ating sa Cordova. So, ongoing pa yung ating mga legal cases doon sa mga nanay. And then, the children are still with the DSWD.
Pero, parang din sa tono niya is eventually, pwede pa rin silang ibalik doon sa magulang nila in spite of the fact that yung mother nila yung nag-force sa kanila sa ganitong trabaho.
Ma'am, kung mismong nanay po ang naglili doon sa mga bata, definitely po, ay hindi po natin ibabalik yung mga bata sa kanila, no? Kasi meron ding case na hinaharap po itong mga magulang. In the event na merong ibang kamag-anak na pwede naman, base doon sa assessment na ating mga social workers, then we can return the children to the nearest guardian na inassistin ng ating mga social workers po.
Tapos pag na-return na ho sila doon sa guardian, tuloy-tuloy ho ba yung counseling services that is being offered by DSWD?
Yes, ma'am. So, ang ating counseling services inside the facility also, and then doon din sa kanilang mga kamag-anak, but this will be handled by our local social welfare development officers, yung ating mga LGU social workers na po. Kasi binalik na po natin ang mga bata doon sa kanilang mga guardian.
Out of the 177 cases, so ilan ho dito was perpetrated by their parents?
Yeah. you know, we will just give the data to you kasi ang mga data ang hawak lang namin, ito lang yung mga datos na status ng mga bata. But we will give the data to your office, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you.
Madam Chair, I have a question. I'll pursue the line of questioning of Senator Binay, ma'am, Assistant Director Sarino. Assume, itong case, parents are involved in the cybercrime, cyberporn. So they're deprived of custody. The children, victim children, are in the SWD's care. Okay. So what would be the legal basis that you are having these kids with you? And then, if you now identify the closest relative and you want now to surrender the kids to the closest relative, can they refuse? Because sabi nila, pampabigat sa amin, di namin ma-afford yan. Then the kids will stay with you. Ang tanong, for how long will they be staying with you? Itong tanong ko kasi, we might need to improve the laws. Gusto kong tignan if covered ka ba sa mga legal basis sa mga actions nyo.
Tama po yung pananaw ng ating mahal na senador na talagang at times nahihirapan po kami, no, to return the child. Kasi wala po talaga mag-aalaga sa kanila. Dahil unang-una, ang pag-aalaga sa kanila, iku-continue din yung kanilang mga obligasyon. But nonetheless, kung makikita po ng ating pamahalaan, for example, the DSWD, who will recommend that this should be provided by the local government social workers, then tutulungan po sila na maibigay yung halimbawa educational assistance, bibigyan ng financial assistance itong kamag-anak na nagsusupport sa batang ito at din exploring kung saan siya pwede makakuha ng sponsorship for further doon sa kanyang educational assistance.
When parents are deprived of parental authority or physically impossible, nakakulong sila, under the law, who takes over as the substitute parents of the child?
Yun pong kanyang kamag-anak, yung mga nearest niya, yung lola niya.
Okay, let us say, so in effect, if ever nasa custody niyo yung mga bata, temporary lang yun, and then you search for these people. Can these people decline to take, to assume the responsibility?
So far naman po, Senator, doon sa mga naibalik na doon sa ibang regions na nakabalik na sa kanilang mga kamag-anak, tinanggap naman
tanggap
po.
Nila.
Opo, tinanggap naman po.
Tapos
sila.
Kung magparinig na nabigatan kami, tutulong kayo. You have a budget ng DSWD, tutulong.
Meron po tayong budget doon. Meron din ang local government because bago po natin, Senator, ibabalik yung mga bata, magkakaroon po ng case conference.
Okay.
Pre-discharge case conference na kung saan ilalatag ng ating mga social workers ang mga plano, paano aalagaan itong batang ito, paano din ipoprotect itong batang ito doon sa magiging nakilala at naa-assist na mag-aalaga nitong mga batang ito. Pero kung sakali man, doon po tayo, Senator, doon sa kung sakali man na wala talagang kamag-anak,
worst case,
kung meron, natatakot na mag-aalaga nitong bata, ang batang ito ay manatili po sa DSWD. Okay? Pero habang sa DSWD, ibibigay po ng DSWD ang kaukulang mga assistance. Halimbawa po, to continue high schooling hangga pong matapos siya, and then tutulungan din siya paano siya ma-employ later on. O kasi hindi po pwedeng magtatagal po siya sa DSWD kasi nahahalo siya doon sa ibang mga bata, na ibang kaso. Ang gusto lang talaga natin kung isang bata na sa DSWD, the ultimate goal of the DSWD is to return them to their family kung meron po. Salamat. Yeah,
so ultimately, worst case scenario, wala talagang tumatanggap sa kanya hanggang 18 siya sa inyo?
Ang aming pong facility ng DSWD, Senator, meron po kami nagmumula talaga nung bata. Opo, di ba, meron kami ang reception and study center for children. Kung halimbawa, pumasok siya ngayon sa Marilac Hills, no? O home for girls na kung saan 18 years old siya. Pagdating po kasi sa edad niya, meron po siyang ibang center na pupuntahan. Okay? And if not, no, kung hindi ma po siya sa DSWD pumasok na residential facilities, we have the license and accredited non-government agencies na talagang sinusupervise din, tinutulungan po ng DSWD, Senator.
If no longer a child, pwede doon, kung talagang walang mapuntahan. Ha? So we have this in place. Ha? You don't need a law to strengthen the system?
Wala po kasi doon sa aming facilities, residential facilities, meron na po tayong manual of operations. And then all the non-government organizations licensed by the SWD, they are also obliged to receive referrals from the SWD.
Madam Chair.
Thank you, Senator.
One more na lang.
Okay. Before your question, Senator, I just want to lay out that the order after the question of Senator Binay, we'll have Ms. Candelaria, Ms. Cisnero, Ms. Candelaria, Mr. De Leon, and then our USEC and the DOJ, and then Mr. Duralbal will be last. So I request, if you can make your presentation or comments, 3 minutes each. So, Senator, go ahead, please.
Yung same scenario nga ako, di ba, magulang yung nagpasok sa kanila sa cyber sex. Technically, who yung bata can be a witness to their parents, di ba? Am I correct?
Ako kasi ay hindi abogado, ako kasi ay social worker. Oo, pero kinukuhanan po namin yung mga bata na na-rescue namin, yung statement. Apa.
I guess maybe DOJ or NBI. Paano ho ba yun? Yung bata ho ba pwedeng mag-witness against their parents?
There are established rules for that, ma'am. And in cases where the child is the one that is, quote-unquote, the victim, we have to qualify it carefully because of what we call admissibility rules. But in terms of a crime, we do not see any barrier for a child to do that.
Kasi I'm just concerned, kasi parang DSWD ho, di ba binibigay nyo sa kamag-anak. Pwede din ho yung scenario na kunyari si Lola, sasabihin niya dun sa bata na wag mong sasabihin na nanay mo yung nagpasok sa'yo sa ganyang trabaho. So pwede ho mangyari yung ganong scenario. So how do we prevent this? Kasi baka mangyayari wala nang mako-convict. Dahil I think for me, the best witness is the child kasi siya yung biktima dito. So may way ho ba of preventing this type of situations?
Yung mismong bata, halimbawa kung siya naman ay nakapag-share, in-interview din siya ng mga law enforcement, nagsasabi din siya na tawag to, nanay niya mismo ang nag-ooperate sila-sila lang sa bahay because one case in Cebu na parang nanay at yung tatlo niya mga anak mo. Oh, so,
Share, baka maganda if you can hear from the NGOs.
Yes, okay. So we'll give you the 3 minutes each for your statements.
Sige po. Diretsyong sagot na lang po dun sa ilang mga tanong. Susugang ko lang din po yung position ng DSWD. In relation to sa policy issues or the gaps na nakikita namin dito, ang gap po talaga, yung reintegration protocol. So bagamat kaya ng regions or even province level, DSWD, mindful of the fact na devolved na po yung social services sa munisipyo, pagbaba na po doon, minsan talaga isang social worker, isang bayan po yun. IJM, International Justice Vision, as a human rights agency and organization, we really closely follow yung prosecution and both the aftercare services po nung mga bata. And that is a protracted battle. We continue to appreciate our partnership with DSWD. Going back to Region 7 specifically, they are even aiming for a separate space. Recently, Director Habagat, even the DSWD secretary was there to in an attempt to really launch sana another space. Pagkilala lang po dun sa katotohanan na tumataas po yung bilang at maaaring kailanganin talaga ng hiwalay na facility for this. And so target-wise, yan po, yung facility'ng hiwalay, baka nga band-aid solution din po siya, pwede nating tawagin ganun, but very definitely most appreciated. Reintegration protocol po, yung transition, nung bagamat may reintegration protocol na po, unofficially siguro ang tingin namin, unfunded mandate po siya. It's a perfectly written manual at the moment. Siguro ang challenge po nung central, pagbaba na sa munisipyo, paano nga ba siya magkakalaman? Kasi babalik siya sa munisipyo na ang problema, bula basura hanggang dun sa mga kabataan. So pagbaba dun, paano ulit yung reintegration? And then as for, we have the rule on the examination of a child witness. And again, we're very strong on if the social workers, both are aftercare and SWD feels na hindi pa ready yung witness to really tell her story in court, then we factor that in, and we do try to factor in other ways by which we can still deliver the testimony of the child without while at the same time avoiding re-traumatization or re-victimization.
Please submit to us your position paper. I think you've made very good points, and we will need that for reference.
And Madam Chair, maybe we can get a copy of the reintegration protocol.
Please note. Miss Candelaria, thank you for patiently waiting.
Thank you. Good afternoon. First, I'm no bishop, but I'm a full-time staff of the Episcopal Commission on Youth. So concerning the youth, so I will bring this concern to them to come up to be for them to be able to come up with a position paper. But given this opportunity to speak, let me focus on three things I've heard. Yung sa detection, I'd like to susugan pa yung sinabi ni Chairman na. Sana maano yung detection in terms of cybercrime, no? We have digital footprints, so maybe if we can outsource the expertise of information technology experts, kasi they can easily trace the IP configuration, the address of the PC kung saan nagmumula yung mga ganyang pornography. Then second, yung aftercare na sinasabi, no? I've been personally visiting a home for the girls in Cabanatuan, in Region 3. And sabi nyo, you've been giving them aftercare and schooling, then employment. But sana yung medyo holistic in terms of their inner struggle. Kasi one thing that I've observed dun sa Region 3, sa home for the girls, no, merong culture na nabibuild sa kanila. Merong hindi na-address na concern. Kaya nangyayari, sometimes, no, the victims becomes the victimizer. So, may culture na nangyayari doon. Sila-sila, sorry for the term, naghihipuan, no? I have talagang hands-on, no? Nakapunta talaga ako doon at nakita ko talaga yung culture na nangyayari. So, I would like to nasabihin din na for them to come up ng mga talagang equipped personnel, hindi lang din yung schooling and employment, but their inner struggle as a person, no? For them to become talagang a citizen. Tapos, third, yung collaboration, no, I can say na we from the CBCP actually after the self-care, no, medyo bago din sa amin, ako personally, yung human trafficking, no, cybercrime and all, but we are really going to the grassroots, no. We are after the formation of the leaders for them to easily detect, for them to easily report. But yun, collaboration, I would like to also, yung kaninang sinabi na kung merong dial or yung easily access na pwedeng whom to report if we have seen, kasi we have people in the grassroots, in the parishes, in the dioceses, if they have this, if they see this matter, whom to report, how to address, yung mga practical tips ba that we can give to the to fellow citizens.
You've made made a very good point about the victim and the victimizer. I would love to have your statement in writing. Please submit that to us because we will use that definitely as reference. Equip personnel taking care of these kids.
Thank you.
Can we move on, ma'am? Next, let me ask Mr. De Leon.
Good afternoon, Your Honor. From Terrorism Netherlands, if you would notice, last November, there was already a release on the Sweetie campaign, wherein you noticed this 10-year-old Filipina, which was aired internationally, and that is our project, the Sweetie Project, and we were able to identify 1,000 perpetrators for 2 months, and from us on our side, it is really easy to locate the perpetrators if you have somehow this high tech technology. Of course, another part for more than 20 years that we have been here in the Philippines, we somehow concentrated on the direct assistance. But because of the demand, the issue of these proliferations of the cyber sex, we are able to concentrate now the three types of operations on these cyber sex. And this has something to do with individual operations, family-run operation and the cyber sex dens. And that is indeed something that in what way we could be able to either lessen or stop this kind of operations, even in the cyber sex dens and for the family run. Our concern has something to do with also with the money transfer establishments. Like, you know, it could be easily get money because when you are already online, no, madali na makakuha ng pera. Ang sabi nga nila daw, pwede na daw to door-to-door. No? So, if you would notice, if someone is has no job, at the same time, no, nakaka-receive ng money, so there's already a question. Secondly, also, our concern has something to do with the Wi-Fi, broadband, and mobile phones. No? Because of the mobile phones, no, anyone can easily communicate the foreigners or the online predators, and in what way we could be able to you know to look for in the, to look on this kind of scenarios, because anyone has mobile phones and using the Skype you can easily communicate no with the predators or the perpetrators. So something like in what way we could come up some legal assistance or aid in this matter. So for us, for Terrorism Netherlands, indeed, for being here in the Philippines for 20 years, we continually support the prevention, protection, promotion, and for the prosecution. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Senator Nancy said, I'm luck for cyber sex. Follow the money sometimes. Yeah. Of course, baka, hindi naman baka bariya-bariya yan. So, tingnan natin. Thank you for your time being here. I would like to end with Asek Geronimo C. and then Attorney Juralbal, mainly because, number one, for the DOJ, to be able to help with for the cybercrime IRR, if you can include a media representation, because there's also balancing here with freedom of expression. Again, there's this anti-cybercrime pornography bill of Senator Loren, wherein kids should not receive pornographic material, etc. But how are you able to track that down? It's about implementation and... So I'd like to have your position on that, sir. If you can give us a brief statement now and what your commitment is, please study the bills that we have. We don't want abdicating any of the rights that we should have. And also the KBP and your concern on freedom of expression, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Quickly, just a comment as the head of the newly established Office of Cybercrime of the Department of Justice. In relation to Senate Bill 532 and A59, we do not believe that we need additional laws on this. As it is, the fight against child pornography, abuse of women and children online, suffers from a cacophony of laws. We have too many of it, which starts with the revised Penal Code 7610, 9208, expanded, 9775, 10175. There's too many laws. It's very confusing for law enforcement. That's the first point, ma'am. The second point is true, vulnerable sectors, women and children, deserve special attention, but it should not be to the price of not prioritizing equally heinous crimes. For example, we have not had successful cases on tracing drug money online. The whole problem of online fraud for businesses, the scams perpetrated on consumers, small human enterprises, on the BPOs, is a burgeoning problem that has also as great an impact as possible. So it requires a refocusing on prioritization. The Office of Cybercrime would actually have three major priorities set out this year. One is child pornography, which is contraband, which is evil per se. It goes beyond any argument, any turf issues, any legal practical problems. The second priority is online fraud. We're hearing a lot of business, especially SMEs, on ATM frauds from consumers. You go online to shop, you pay, you don't get the goods. You get inferior goods. These are bigger problems as much as it is, because it takes away from prioritization of basic necessities. The third priority we have is network security in terms of what we're seeing, especially in the geopolitical arena, when senators and the legislators would still use Gmail and Yahoo for exchanges of confidential email. That those are security breaches of the highest order. And the last 2 points, Madam, is given the nature of cybercrime, we're seeing law enforcement requiring full ministerial department approach, because a lot of these law enforcement issues can terminate in localized physical search and warrants. But the bigger problem is getting the evidence and data from servers which could be in Singapore, States, Netherlands, anywhere it is, which requires what we call an expedited process worldwide, so that wherever child porn is located, in whatever server, in whatever jurisdiction, we're able to preserve and hopefully secure that data for further prosecution and conviction, which is the end line of any cybercrime investigation. The last point, ma'am, and this makes reference to Senator Binay and Senator Pimentel's concern on the DSWD, is it's very difficult to solve this particular aspect of child and lolo and parents, for the simple reason that we are using the wrong reference. We're using a criminal justice response only as to this problem. We have not explored adequately administrative and civil remedies to address the whole problem. There is a criminal justice response to corruption, to money laundering, to drugs. That's a very clear criminal justice response from a criminal research theory. But if you apply the same criminal justice response of convicting parents, it's not the correct frame to use it, because for two reasons. One, you're not recognizing the socioeconomic fabric, the ties that is unique in the Philippines. Second is just for evidentiary thresholds. Proof beyond reasonable doubt is something that is reserved for the most heinous crimes. A lot of these crimes are economic, social in nature. So we'd like to end that with that particular response.
Please submit your position, especially for the administrative solution.
And civil, ma'am.
What we can do in that particular aspect, so we can move forward in this and we can act on the needs. Thank you for your presence and for your very informative presentation.
Thank you, ma'am.
Attorney Muralbalf, in closing.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and Senator Pimentel. Good afternoon. I failed to greet you a while ago. But anyway, insofar as cyber crime is concerned, the main concern of KBP, of course, is the cyber libel. We have submitted our position papers on this, and particularly it can constitute double jeopardy and all of that. But we'd also like to focus on the matters taken this afternoon, particularly on cyber pornography, because the KBP is an honorary member of the Committee on the Special Protection of the Child. The protection of the child is a special advocacy of the KBP. And insofar as cybercrime law is concerned, even with the IRR, we would very much suggest that we put a provision on the preparation of information materials, because part of solving crimes is the institutional aspect of informing people of this matter so that there is a prevention level. So if there is a provision which requires the agencies, for example, to prepare information materials on this, this is something that the KBP can be of help. As a student of law, particularly on information technology, Your Honors, I'd like to suggest certain things, matters that were raised, and points that I'd like to put attention to. A while ago, Senator Binay raised the issue of what if the parents try to tell the child not to say anything. Perhaps we can consider putting a provision in the law on the matter of presumption, that once the crime is being committed inside the house, the presumption should be that the parents are responsible for it, so that there's a shifting of presumptive evidence. There was also the matter of, we noticed in cybercrime-related laws, there's a matter of the issue of jurisdiction, because of the revised penal code that states that a crime can be prosecuted in any place where it was committed. And in cybercrime law, that's practically the whole world. So it might be a matter of looking into the issue of jurisdiction, or defining the jurisdiction insofar as the commission of cybercrime law is concerned. Then there's the matter of the use of technology to transfer funds. It was pointed out a while ago by Mr. De Leon that the payment is done through technology also. Pasaload, in fact, is very much used even in Huetin, for that matter. there is a parallel, there's a similar law, Your Honor, the use of the postal services for commission of fraud. This can be looked into, and therefore the use of the information highway for transfer of funds to support an illegal transaction can be considered can be defined as a crime if there is a law to do that, Your Honors. So those are just some suggestions, Your Honor, but we'd like to reiterate that in so far as cybercrime is concerned, other than the matter of cyber libel, the KBP very much supports the cybercrime law.
Okay. Thank you so much for your time today. Gentlemen, I'd like to acknowledge also the presence of Alberto Salvador. Maraming salamat po, sir. Do you want to add something for 2 minutes?
Thank you, Madam Chairperson, for inviting us. We are sorry that Yusuke Kasambre could not come here because of a medical reason. However, together with the DOJ and the PNP and NBI and the other members of the coordinating body for implementation of the RA 10175, we will certainly engage the private sector in further creating further awareness on the cybercrime laws, wherein even a minor is now the primary victim.
Thank you very much. Please submit your position papers, your beautiful ideas. If you need our email or whatever, Javi, just Luke. Don't forget to submit, sir, from the PNP also. Okay, thank you. The meeting is suspended. Thank you.